Hey YouTube, it's Luke here from Astro Awakening, and this video is explaining from an occult, esoteric, symbolic perspective why certain people can't see what's really going on. One of the questions I get asked a lot on my social media platforms, even in my readings, is how can people not see this? How can they not see what's really going on? And I think that the best way to answer that question is to look at the symbolism around the mind and how the mind works. So this is using astrology tarot and just some symbolism hidden in plain sight, perhaps. But I've learned this through my spiritual practices. I began in 2015 and I was studying from a book called Kabbalah, Magic and the Great Work of Self-Transformation by Liam Thomas Christopher. And this is actually described in the book, and I sort of adapted and adopted that from and given it my own sort of interpretation. So I don't take full credit for this. This isn't coming from me. This is coming from, you know, other areas, source, as well as, and as you'll find out, intuition. Okay, so let's dive in and see if we can make some sense of this. So hopefully right now you can see the tarot card on the screen, the number 6 tarot card, which is the Lover's card. And this is the card symbolically that represents the zodiac sign of Gemini. And you think Gemini, right? It's a mutable air sign, and Gemini is ruled by Mercury, which is the mind. Why is the card, the Lover's card, depicted for this? Let's just get rid of that. That makes it a little bit easier. So, and there are, the thing to understand with symbolism is that a symbol can have multiple meanings, right? So there's not just one meaning for a symbol. When we, it's just like words, for example, like the word week. The word week can mean a length of time, you know, 7 days, 5 days, the working week, but it also can mean that you are the opposite of strong, weak. Something is weak, it's not very strong. So even words can have multiple meanings, and symbols convey multiple meanings. They're often used in our culture. You know, the saying that the world is ruled by signs and symbols, not words and nor laws. So, and I believe that's attributed to Confucius. So the world is ruled by signs and symbols, not words nor laws, which is very interesting. As you awaken and you begin your process of self-awareness, self-actualization, and erasing of your consciousness, what happens is you start to come across symbols, things that are happening, coincidences, synchronicities, little things that match up. How many people in their awakening start seeing synchronistic numbers, you know, numbers like repetitive 111 or 333 or 666, you know, on the clock or in number plates and things like that? These are symbols. They're conveying information to your conscious awareness has been brought to the attention of that symbol for whatever reason. And that's the thing, is that they're always there, symbols. But our awareness is guided to the symbols that we are interacting with. And you could say that perhaps your intuition or your higher self, your guardian angel, your holy guardian angel, perhaps it's the force that's guiding your awareness to look at that clock at that moment, right? Oh, wow, there it is. If that is happening, as a side note, it's about what were you thinking about just prior to seeing the 111. And often it's a recognition, or it's a way to reinforce some sort of thought or belief that you've just had. And then you can look deeper into the meaning of the actual numbers, but this isn't the video to do that. So what I want you to draw your attention to with this card is that you've got this sort of male and female figure, and they seem to be landing and standing on Earth. Then you've got the sky, this cloud area, and above this you have this sort of angel figure, right, with the sun behind, and whether that's a depiction of divinity, God, higher self, holy guardian angel. But you could sort of say that just symbolically looking at this, is these are humans, people grounded on Earth. In fact, you know, being naked like that, we could even say maybe that's Adam and that's Eve. Here is the tree of knowledge, and here is the tree of this is the tree of life over here, also known as the Kabbalah. And this is the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, with the serpent tempting who? Eve in the Garden of Eden. It's a little bit barren, this garden. These characters are symbolic in the card of Gemini, right? The union of the lovers is symbolic of an aspect of mind. And we could say that this would be the masculine aspect of our mind, and this would be the feminine aspect of our mind, because we are in Gemini, and Gemini is ruled by Mercury, and Gemini is a mutable air. Air is the element that rules over thought, right? Communication. These are aspects of air. And then the mutability is the adaptability, the changing, the different polarities and different divisions of the mind and different points of view and perspective, and the changing and the openness and the curiosity that the mind can do. It can go from one thought to the next, that can communicate those. So that's the mutable aspect of Gemini. But if we look at this male figure, this would be representative of the masculine aspect of mind. And the masculine aspect of mind is the left brain. And the left brain is renowned for rational reasoning, logic. Okay, it said wants to work things out, wants to calculate them. It sort of, you know, is the more, what's the word? Academic aspect of mind, right? Academia. So we call that the sort of masculine brain. And the masculine aspect is for working things out. It's for, you know, understanding things, breaking them down into their simple forms, analyzing. All the analytical aspect of mind happens in the masculine aspect of mind. And it's projective, as masculine energy is. So it's outward expressive, right? It's outward expressive. It's identifying things. It's looking into the world, right? And it's sort of having this, its own understanding or knowing of the interpretation of what's happening. If we look at this part of the brain, this would be the feminine aspect of mind. Okay, this feminine aspect of mind is the intuitive, the sensitive, the emotional. We could say that the masculine aspect rules over the conscious thinking part of the brain, and the feminine aspect would rule over the subconscious. And then that aspect of our mind also rules over those types of functions within our body that we don't think about. An example of that is the blood circulation, the beating of the heart, the firing of the messages, even breathing. And that's linked into this, because breathing, you know, breath, right? And breath, let's think Gemini rules the lungs, and lungs are our capacity and ability to breathe. And we have two lungs. And the thing with breathing, breath, is its dual function. It can be done by the masculine part of the brain. It can be done by the feminine subconscious part, the conscious part or the unconscious or subconscious part. Let's start with the unconscious. The unconscious part of breathing is when you're sleeping at night. You're deep in sleep. You're not thinking about breathing, but your subconscious is taking over the process of breathing. Same when I'm talking to you now. I'm not having a conversation with you now and thinking about breathe in, breathe out, breathe in, breathe out. However, if I were to up my exercise or go for a swim, hold my breath, or I wanted to do some breath work, some pranayama, some breathing exercises, I could use my conscious brain to take over the function of breathing. And now my masculine, projective, assertive, masculine thinking brain, conscious brain, can take over the function of this unconscious or subconscious aspect, right? But coming back to the feminine also is receptive. This was projective, right? Outward projection. This is receptive. It receives. The masculine brain or aspect of mind is projective, putting its mind into things, thinking about things. The feminine aspect of mind is receptive. And well, that's where we get all our impressions from, and our feelings have a connection to our receptive, right? So do we feel things, we receive impulses, energies, sensitivities, and we are activated in our feeling body. It's also the intuitive body. It's also the aspect of mind that functions over the interpretation of symbols. When we see symbols, they bypass the logic brain and they actually communicate to our subconscious brain. So you might see a symbol of, water, right? And that might mean something to you with your functioning conscious brain, but on an unconscious level, that can mean so many things. It might mean emotions, because water and emotions are the same. They might mean money. There's lots of different things that can mean. And symbol of water is going to imprint that information into our subconscious. What I want you to look at in this card is that the masculine man is looking towards, we'll call this Adam and Eve, right? Adam, or the conscious masculine brain, is looking towards Eve. And Eve is looking towards the higher self, divinity, angel, holy guardian angel, God, whatever you want to call this aspect, right? Call this your higher self. So the higher self is pervading over all aspects and it sees all. And it's unencumbered and it can access both as elements here. And it is this the observer sort of mindset. But what happens is we receive intuition, guidance. We receive subtle impulses, sensitivities, emotions. We can receive feelings from our higher self, because that's the aspect of the mind that it's interacting with. And that's indicated here by Eve looking towards the higher self. Adam is looking towards Eve, and his view of higher self is obstructed by this aspect of cloud in between. And cloud is an indication or representation of air, and that's a representation of thought. And the understanding here is that because the thinking brain, the masculine thinking brain, right, the reasoning, rationale, logic brain, it's the thought, it's the thinking that obscures the connection into divinity, because it's projecting thought. Whereas the feminine aspect of our brain, the subconscious, is not in the process of thought. It can receive. Right. So these are the aspects of mind: masculine thinking, rational reasoning. There's the thinking part of our mind. And this is the receiving, receptive, intuitive, feeling, sensitivity, subconscious aspect of our mind. We can actually expand these symbols out into reality, and we can look and say that there's man and woman on this earth. And men tend to be more masculine with their thoughts, their thinking. You know, any woman would tell you when she's having a moment and she's feeling sad, what does a man try to do? He tries to fix it, right? He's analyzing it. He's trying to make sense of it. And he's then going to project that into her. And what does she want? She just wants to be held, or she just wants to be heard. She doesn't want this process of thinking. And then we can have women sometimes that are ultra sensitive, and they can lose rational reasoning. I'm not sure what I should do if they get emotional overwhelm. And this is a stereotype, and I don't mean any sort of offense, and please don't take any, but like map reading is not necessarily something that women are traditionally renowned for. And I'm going to get all the haters of the sexes, whatever. You get my point of view, is that there are some aspects of reality that men are really good at, and some aspects that women are really good at. And that is because they're polarized genetically or into this human form into a particular polarity. Now, that's not to say that men can't be feminine and women can't be masculine. In fact, the lovers is about the divine union between both aspects of mind. And it's the union of both aspects of mind that really opens us up to our higher self. But here's the thing, and this video is about trying to understand why most people can't see what's going on. And here's the thing, to see what's really going on at the moment, you can't think your way into it. You have to get information, and you have to allow that to activate your intuition, your knowing, your instinct, your gut, that feeling. How many people over the last 2 years have gone, something's not right here? Based on what? Based on the information you're receiving, or based on the subtle influence that you're receiving from your higher self, the knowing? When you have the knowing is coming not from thought. The knowing is coming from a combination of the two. The knowing has come from a connection to intuition, and then the ability to analyze that intuition and be like, this is right, this feels right. Or the opposite is, this doesn't feel right, this feels wrong. So where are the majority of people in our society, and especially those that have high intelligence, follow the academia pathway into, college, university education, degrees, doctorates, masters, people that, they've got lots and lots of letters after their name. Well, they are filling this aspect, right? A science, is another good indication of this sort of masculine, like wanting to break things down and work and analyze them, and like, how does it work, and trying to think that they can know, science thinks it can know God or divinity. We're trying to find the God particle. But the thing is, no amount of thought can ever connect us to the true divinity, the true higher self, the true intuition, because it's a reception. We receive that information. But what happens in this culture is that we've had the information, that's been manipulated. This part here has been obscured. And now what's happening is only certain information is coming through to our thinking, rational reasoning part of our brains, or in the collective in general, right? So, and that's what we would call propaganda, media propaganda, government propaganda, right? It's the manipulation of information to control the thought processes of people. Now, the vast majority of people that are in a particular level of consciousness or self-awareness, or what we would call, they're not necessarily awake yet, they haven't yet accessed this process of receiving intuition, guidance, instinct, gut feeling, and knowing, right? They're stuck in this aspect here of thinking that they know. And what happens is, they've elevated, and we have as a culture, we've elevated knowledge and intelligence and intellect and rationale and reason. We've elevated that to a status of God, right? Someone with all the numbers up, and they've gone down the pathway, and they're a professor, and now they're in with the WHO, or we're in with the high order in the government. Well, they must be the source of knowledge here. So we've given them, godlike status. And if it comes from them, well, it must be truth. The truth of the matter is, it's the divine union of the mind and the access of our feminine receptivity that connects us to our higher self, which this aspect of self, the higher self, knows all, sees all. This is where knowledge, truth, knowledge, gnosis truly comes from. It's not from reading a book, studying, and then going to and writing a thesis, right? It's the ability to access your intuition and to then analyze and, run that through your thought process. And the combination, the divine union of these things brings about truth. As you awaken, what you do is you start to, this relationship starts to build, right? You start to be guided more. There's a gut feeling. Like, most of the things that have happened since my awakening have been like major profound transitions in my life, of being just following my gut, just surrendering really to it, not needing to have it all worked out. That was the old style of me, and thought and mind was like needing it all worked out. And this is like people that want to have control of everything, control of every little detail in reality. And when the world is chaotic as it is, they can become quite anxious and unstable, because all of a sudden they haven't, like, I thought I had it all worked out, right? How many people, when they have their awakening, that's the process they go through, is like they had thought they had their worldview worked out, and they realize like the world is a lot different than we've been made to think, right? This would also be the rational reasoning masculine aspect of mind, would also be where the fundamental sort of ego would reside, this identification, right? And people that have invested heavily in their education through the current indoctrination system of education, right, have invested heavily into this identification with their mind, their knowledge, their letters after their name, right? They've really overinflated this aspect of mind. And now when presented with alternate information or something that goes against this investment and identification of this knowledge, they will have what they call cognitive dissidence. They will just reject it and defend their position, even if it becomes irrational. Because to confront or challenge that aspect of their knowing, their mind, would be to confront that aspect of ego. They would have to then break their identification with that. And that would be a collapse of identity, an identity crisis, an egoic death, massive. And most people are fearful of that. And the ego will keep them in this place of comfort. You find too that people that get into these types of high educational intelligent perspectives become very dogmatic, moralistic, quite arrogant. Well, they must know because they wrote a thesis or whatever it was, right? Why do you think, if we go back into history, that women, and I won't use the word witches because they weren't witches, they were just women with a really awakened, receptive connection to nature and source and intuition and higher self and God. Why do you think they were burnt at the stake? Why do you think they were ostracized? Why do you think this aspect of the divine feminine is so heavily degraded within our culture and society? We have this rise of this toxic femininity at the moment, which is just rubbish. The divine feminine is this beautiful, receptive, awake, aware, sensitive, emotional, compassionate energy that is so intuitive. Why is it that women far outnumber people that have psychic abilities, intuition, you know, mediumistic skills, those sorts, than men? And not to say that there aren't men, right? This is not a sexist thing to divide people and say, well, only men can do this and only women. No, because there are a lot of men that can do that and there's a lot of women that can't. But as a generalization, women are way more receptive. They're way more intuitive. They're way more psychic. They're way more connected, right? We have this, you know, the symbol at the moment is we're all in this together. We're all in this together. We're all in this together, right? Well, the word together is to get her, right? And we're not all in this together. They're using this propaganda to control the mind. And in the terms and the symbols and the words they're using is saying, we're all in it together. No, we're not. We're all in it to get her. They don't want this part of divinity, right? And this is divine also, the divine masculine, absolutely divine. It's not to say that this is better or worse, but without the divine union, without the connection of both aspects, the divine masculine with the united divine woman, there is no hope for us to connect to intuition, source, God. There is no hope. And whilst we continue to listen to these so-called elevated intellectual, intelligent, bloody, you know, doctorates and professors, and, you know, they come on the TV and they're behind the scenes advising the government, and they're just basically unbalanced, imbalanced, disconnected from self and source, very materialistic and scientific, which brings me to the next slide. And here's a card that's somewhat similar to the Lovers, known as the Devil. We still have this masculine figure, like this Adam, and we still have this Eve. Now they've got horns. And they've got this goat deity, this horned goat deity, half man, half goat deity behind them, instead of this archangel sort of divine higher self, holy guardian angel aspect. And this is the Baphomet or goat-like god or pan god, right? And what's happened here is they're now chained to what? To the rock, chained to this black box, right? Does that look like this? Does that not represent this? In some respects, but that basically is materialistic, right? When we become completely detached from divinity and we worship materialism, science, we worship possessions, material possessions, we become bound to them, right? And ruled over by what is known as the devil, right? We are supposed to enjoy this physical reality, but not become attached to it, not become attached to this physical reality. How many people right now are wanting the world to go back to how it was because they were attached to their comfort, their security, right? The way it was just like, it was just comfortable. We're all ruled over by the devil. We're not going back here, right? But at the moment, in order for them to administer or, you know, pull off this agenda of theirs for whatever nefarious reasons, they have to get us, you know, thinking, they've used propaganda to get us thinking that this is where the only thing that matters. This is the only thing that matters. The old life, the old job, the old everything, right? How it was, getting back. What's going to get us back to normal? Don't you want to get, well, we're going to remove all those things that you are so heavily attached to. Now we're going to say, you can have them back. You can be back in this reality, but what have you got to do? What have you got to do? There's no other way to describe it, but you've got to sell your soul. To go back to that reality, you have to sell your soul. You have to make a deep compromise of your soul. And it's because that you have disconnected from this divine energy and believe that this physical world, right, is all there is, and you've become attached to it. And it's not the case. It's temporal. Physical material matter is maya or illusion. That is the illusion. You know, it's to become attached to these physical aspects of reality. That job, this house, that money, that car, more, right? The measure of value is like, how much do you have? How much have you collected? Like I mentioned in my last video, was like, you come into this world like this, you leave this world like this, right? Nothing, right? We've become so detached from that, and now attached to physical things. We want more and more and more of them. We've got to have them. That's all fixing to change. So when you say, you know, how come people can't see what's really going on? Why can't they see? Because they're in this aspect of mind. They're not in this divine union, right? They're in this aspect of mind, thinking that they know what's going on. But this aspect of information, propaganda, has been corrupted to control the thoughts. Control the thoughts, control the beliefs, control the beliefs, control your world. This world, your reality is controlled by your beliefs, right? So whatever you believe is what your reality will represent. So those that control the information, which controls the thoughts, which then controls the beliefs, get to control this world, this reality. And at the moment, those in control of that, every system, media and government, education and health and finance and every system and legal system, every single one has been corrupted by the intellectuals. Some of them don't want that. They despise this aspect. Right? And they want to play God here. So wake up. Connect to your feminine receptivity. Meditate. Start to see the symbols. Start to challenge your beliefs. The intellects, the really, really smart people, are often the last people, if at all, to awaken. Because for them, they already are God. There's nothing to awaken to. And it's far, far from the truth. So hopefully that's helped you understand why some people cannot see what's going on. Now, your challenge with that is not to try to scream and shake them. It's to lead by example. It's to create this divine union, the lovers, right? Connect to both aspects of self, the masculine and the feminine. Come into the centered place of the heart and live from there, in spite of what's going on. It's not to wave your finger at them. It's not to judge them. It's not to scream at them. It's not to call them out. It's just to accept that that's where they're at. If you really want change in your reality, you have to come back to yourself and worry about yourself and be in that bliss heart state. Make the changes in your world to get into that. You cannot change what's happening in the world at the moment outside of you, but you can change the way you respond to it. And that in nature will change your reality. And that's the power we have, is we have the power to change how we respond to any given circumstances. And the human capacity for compassion and empathy and love and bliss and joy and optimism is endless. It's unlimited. At the moment, we don't want to use this devil as an excuse. We want to confront that and say, no more. No more. Right? So hopefully that's been helpful for you guys. If you've liked that breakdown, please hit the like button and share this video around your social media platforms. If you want to get a personal reading and dive deep into your own, astrology and help to connect to your own higher self or self-awareness and your intuition and your purpose, your meaning for existence, if you want to overcome challenging situations in your life, then you can find my details in the description below. Until then, take care of yourselves, and remember compassion for self and others. See you guys.